was a beautiful thing to behold, okay? A beautiful thing. It was a beautiful thing. Yeah, that's great. Just keep filling them in. That's right. Isn't it better that we're starting now? We have to. They're not happy outside, but what the heck are we going to do? So it was a beautiful thing to behold. But think of this. So we got almost 14 million votes. We won 36, 37 states, which is, others won none. People that won none are saying, maybe we can get something at the convention. Doesn't work that way, folks. You would have, because we have, you know, one of the things the polls say, we have by far the most loyal followers, right? By far. You know, other of the candidates, well, I mean, take a look at this today. They've never had anything like this where every room is full, every conference room, every restaurant is loaded with people. I hope you put closed circuit in, Phil. They're going to be so angry, but I think you did. This guy doesn't hold back, believe me. But so when we get 37 states, when we get 37 states, we love our police. We love our police. Thank you. Thank you, officers. Thank you. Thank you. That's very nice. Thank you. By the way, how great are our police, okay? They don't get enough credit. They don't get enough credit. They don't. They take abuse. They don't get the credit they deserve, believe me. So we won 37 states. We won 14 million. We beat Ronald Reagan, who we love. We beat Richard Nixon. We beat Dwight D. Eisenhower. We beat everybody. We beat Bush. We beat the Bushes. We like edged it. I don't mean like, you know, I mean by a lot. And now you have a couple of guys that were badly defeated and they're trying to organize maybe like a little bit of a delegate revolt, maybe. Now, number one, you know, Reince Priebus, you know what that is, right? RNC. You know he's a good guy. And the Republican National Committee, they put out a statement, you can't do it. It's not legal. You can't do it. You're not allowed to do it. How would you like to have a party where we started off with 17 or 18 people, actually, including somebody that I won't mention because I'm not looking to embarrass anybody, but it was actually 18 if you want to include somebody, okay? But how would you like to have a party, Wayne? And he's married to a great lawyer, so she understands this better than Wayne does. But Wayne has a much better voice, right? But how would you like to have a party where myself and others traveled the country and worked for a long time? Now, it was shorter than I thought because, remember, I was supposed to maybe be able to pull it out at the convention, and we pulled it out 2 months before the convention. Do you remember? Do you remember when they said 1,237, that's the delegates, 1,230. He cannot reach that number. He cannot reach that number. And I kept saying, what's the big deal? And one of the people, who probably hasn't quite given up yet, one of the people was trying to buy up all of the second ballot people, right? And I kept saying, let them have them, because it's expensive to get them. And by the way, I spent less money than any other candidate, and I ended up in first place, and they ended up, boom. So now I hear, after beating them fair and square, I mean, I beat them fair and square, actually, a couple of the commentators that are negative people, actually, because most of them are, but a couple of the commentators that are negative people said, whether you like him or you don't, he beat them fair and square. And then they said, he didn't beat them by a little bit. He beat them by a lot. We beat them by a lot. Right? So how would you like to have a party where somebody goes out and beats them by a lot, and wins not only the vote, largest in the history of the party, not only wins 37 states and nobody else was even, you know, like remotely close. I mean, some of these guys have none. How would you like to have that? A guy sets an all-time record, gets almost four. And it's the biggest subject in all of Texas. They had helicopters over. They couldn't believe what they were seeing. They've never seen anything like it. And our crowds are bigger. Our enthusiasm is more. A poll came out, OAN, a very good poll. It's a very good group of people. A poll, OAN, came out where I'm statistically even with Crooked Hillary. And she is crooked, folks. Believe me, she is crooked. Hillary Clinton doesn't have, I'll tell you what, Hillary Clinton, and you can say it any way you want, but she doesn't have the integrity. She doesn't have the integrity to be president. And perhaps equally important, she's got very, very bad judgment. You just look at what she's done. You just look, okay. So how would you like to be in a party where Trump wins, where Trump keeps winning, where Trump has the biggest crowds, where Trump gets, by the way, the highest ratings in the history of television? They had a story in Variety. I don't like to brag, but we have to brag every once in a while, right? They had a story in Variety where a big headline, a big, massive headline, and the story was that Trump makes massive profits for cable networks, and networks, but massive. And then it went on to say that they're setting records in viewership, they're setting records in advertising, they're making a fortune. What are we getting out of it? We get nothing, but maybe we're going to get the presidency and we're going to straighten out our country, okay? We're going to straighten out our country. And we'll have Wayne at that inaugural ball. Wayne will be with me. Wayne. Ba, ba, ba. So there's a little movement, and I just heard today where it's coming from. It's coming from people that have been badly defeated. But wouldn't that be funny? Okay. A guy got much less votes. He got no states. Ladies and gentlemen, our nominee is... I don't think so. I mean, forget about the legality, because it's not legal. Forget about the fact that the Republican National Committee put out a statement last night saying, it's all made up by the press, folks, believe me, by these people right here. It's all made up by the press. Okay? It's all made up. It's a hoax, I'm telling you. These are the most dishonest people. Not all of them. But this is a story. I watched CNN yesterday, knowing it can't happen. Breaking news. There will be this and that at the convention. Who are they going to pick? I've beat everybody. But I don't mean beat. I beat the hell out of them. Right? Beat the hell out of them. And we're going to beat Hillary. And it would be helpful if the Republicans could help us a little bit, you know, okay? Just a little bit. I mean, I have people that I've done so much for, that frankly we've done a great job for, all of us. You know, the Republican Party has increased the voter turnout. Forget about me. I set the all-time record. Guess what? The Republican Party in the primaries is up 70%, right? I think it's even more. 70% from 4 years ago. 70% more people have voted in the primaries. Is it because of me? Stand up, say it. A woman. I'm doing well with women. Go ahead. Thank you. Believe me, I respect women more than Hillary respects women. I can tell you that. Thank you. They're screaming, it's because of you, Mr. Trump. It's because of you. And you know what? I never brag. They happen to be 100% right. All right. You take a look at these states. A couple of the states were up 102% from last year, okay, from 4 years ago. 102%, it's unheard of. In the whole world, people talk about it. I mean, some people would have said the Republican Party is staid. It's not bad, staid. It's, you know, it's got a little boring, maybe. And maybe the ideas weren't right, because I don't believe in the, let it be boring if the ideas are right. But the ideas weren't right. There wasn't strength on the border. Our budgets are way out of whack. Look at this last budget that we approved, the omnibus budget. You know, Obama is a horrible negotiator. Iran beats him. Every country beats him. He draws the line in the sand. They beat him. Everybody beats him. But he's a great negotiator when he has to negotiate against the Republicans. And we got to stop. We got to stop. We got to stop. They have to focus on budgets, not focus on me. And they view me as an outsider. I have to tell you a little secret. I shouldn't say it. Half of you will leave the room. Should I say it? I used to be the ultimate establishment person. I was a massive giver. I gave a lot of money to everybody. I even gave to Democrats. I mean, I'm in business, right? I gave to Democrats. I gave to Republicans. But I gave a lot of money. The RGA, Republican Governors Association, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I was like establishment. And then one day I said, you know, I'm going to run. And I announced. And they said, what happened? That's no good. Because I'm not one of them. Because I'm going to do the right thing. I don't need this, folks. I don't need this. I don't need this. Phil Ruffin told me this morning, came over, we met. And he's done such an amazing job with this hotel. And his wife is actually much more amazing than him. Alexandra, stand up, please. Stand up. She's more amazing than Phil. Mr. and Mrs. Phil Ruffin. And he told me this morning, he said, and he was talking to a group of people, and we're raising money for the Republican Party. And frankly, I like doing it. I went around yesterday, I think between yesterday and today, we raised $12 or $13 million for the Republican Party. It's good. For the Republican Party. And somebody said, well, you're not raising money for, I said, I don't know. You know, I get people, I'm raising money for the Republican Party, and I'm not getting the kind of support. What they don't tell you, though, is I actually have a lot of support. But they don't talk to the people that support. Wayne Issa, who's a great guy, congressman. So many of the Republicans are so supportive, they don't want to talk about them. If somebody says something just a little bit off, headline, blaring news, breaking news. You know, they use the breaking news every time there's an event, it's breaking news. Then when you have a real breaking news event, nobody takes it seriously. You have it on breaking news. Donald Trump got up today and tweeted, good morning. Crazy. Crazy. But they don't talk about that. But I will say, Phil said to me this morning, and he said to a group, he said, you know, Donald Trump didn't need to do this. He's made a fortune. He's done a great job, has a great family. An unbelievable, Phil, do I have an unbelievable business? Stand up, please. This guy knows better than I. Stand up. Stand up. Did I do a good job? Built an unbelievable business. And I built an unbelievable business. A great, great business. Some of the greatest assets in the world, no matter where. Who's that guy? Is he a friend or foe? All right, get him out of here, please. Get him out. Get him out. Yeah, get him out. You know, could you let somebody else take his place, please? Different, right? Thank you very much. These are like love fests. You know, a friend of mine came over to me. And he said, very rich guy, very successful guy. Not a great guy, but who cares about that? We need these people to help us negotiate with China and with other countries. Right? But he's a guy that is very successful. And he was at an arena where I had 21,000 people. And I was speaking. And he said, and he's got a lot of guts, financial guts, I call it. You know, different kind of guts. Like, I have financial guts. When I see what our great military people do, I don't know that I'd have those kind of guts, right? Right? These people are fantastic. We've got to take care of our military, take care of our vets. We have to replenish our military, and we have to knock the hell out of ISIS. Have to knock the hell out of ISIS. But he came up to me, and he was with me at this arena, and he saw, it was in Dallas, and 21,000 people, the Mavericks Arena, packed, including the whole floor. And he said, could I ask you a question? How long have you prepared for this speech? How the hell do you get out there in front of that many people? I said, that's nothing, because all the networks are covering it live, just like they are right now. He said, how do you do it? Thank you, darling. You're right. She gets it. You're right. And I said, honestly, and he said, how do you do this? He said, she understands. But he said, how do you do this? How do you speak in front of that many people? He said he could never do it. I said, it's not hard, because I'm telling you, there is such love in this room. There is such love in this room. I really mean it. I really, really mean it. There is such love in these arenas. We had in Mobile, Alabama, we had 35,000 people. We started in a hotel ballroom. After about an hour, the hotel call said, we can't handle it. We then moved to the convention center. That holds 10,000 people. They told us after 2 hours they can't handle it. We moved to a football stadium in Mobile. We had the most unbelievable time. We had 35,000 people. In Oklahoma, we have these massive crowds. We have massive crowds everywhere. And it's so easy to do what I'm doing because it's love. It really is love. I'm doing it for love. I'm doing it for this country. We are so off track. We are so off track. So, and I'll tell you something. The safest place, thank you, darling. The safest place to be in this country is at a Trump rally. Remember that. Remember that. It's the safest place to be. Oh, good. All the seats have now filled out. And there's still, they just said there's 3,000 people outside. All the seats are now filled out. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. The press, I'm telling you, we had to do that. That's why I waited. Is it okay that I waited? Yes. Okay. Now they're all filled out. Filled out all over this building. I don't know. This guy Ruffin must be making a fortune this morning. I don't know. So the safest place to be, seriously, and our whole theme is make America great again. But I've revised it. It's make America great again. It's make America safe again. Safe again. It's make America safe again. And it's also, we want to do it for everybody, not just us. We want to do it for everybody. We want to help African Americans. You look at African American. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, man. African-American youth has a 59% rate of unemployment. Okay, folks, 59. And we're letting people pour into our country. We have no idea who the hell they are, where they come from. There's no documentation. There's no paper. They come from hostile countries. They come from countries that are tremendous in terms of terrorism. And we're going to have big problems. If you think Orlando was the end of it with this weak attitude and this pathetic president that we have, it wasn't, folks. It wasn't. It wasn't. This is just the beginning. Unless we get smart and tough and vigilant, and unless we say, I'm sorry, you're coming from a region in the world, whether it's, and I can name them all, boy, I can name them all, but it's radical Islamic terrorism. It's a whole new thing. It's radical Islamic terrorism. And it's not guns. You know, I saw the president talk immediately about guns. It's not guns. It's terrorism. It's terrorism. It's not guns. It's terrorism. And I watched him the other day, and he was, and by the way, this wasn't just me saying it. He was more angry at Donald Trump than he was at the shooter, the maniac who killed all of those young people. He was more angry at Donald Trump, and I wasn't the only one to say it, plenty of people saw it, that he was at the shooter. So we got to change our mindset here, folks. We have to be really tough, really smart, really strong. You know, in the past, we'd have a war, and we'd be fighting Japan, and they had uniforms. We knew who we were fighting. And we'd be fighting Germany, and we'd be fighting others, and we knew who our opponent was. We knew who the enemy was. Today, you don't know who the hell it is. And you are going to have problems, the likes of which you've never seen, unless Donald Trump becomes your president. Believe me. Believe me. Thank you. Thank you. Now, we're going to bring jobs into our country, and that's going to solve a lot of problems. It's amazing how jobs can solve a lot of problems. Problems that we think we have, all of a sudden, somebody gets a good job, and you don't have the problems. But we're having our jobs ripped off and being sent to other countries, ripped off by currency manipulation, where they're lowering the value of their currency and they're making it impossible for our companies to compete. We're being ripped off at every level. And we have leaders that are so stupid, they have no idea what's happening. I mean, look at the newspapers today. Apple, good old Apple. I was waiting for this to happen. They've been having their stuff made in China, and now China has turned against them. Now, here's the bad news. By my saying that, China's very smart. They're going to say, oh boy, Trump's picked up this one. We'll let Apple. I am doing such a service to Apple by even mentioning it, because our word is being broadcast all over the world, and Tim Cook should send us a lot of money for what I'm doing. But China is now ripping off Apple, saying you don't have the right to sell a certain product in China because somebody else has the right. And they're ripping them off big league. And right now, Apple doesn't know what to do. But it always happens. But you watch. Because of this, this will be a headline. Now China, they're smart. I deal with them. They're very smart. You can do great with them. I made a lot of money with China. The biggest bank in the world is my tenant. I sell condos like crazy to people from China. The Bank of America building in San Francisco, indirectly through China. I mean, so much stuff. I did great with China. And I have great respect for China. I'm not knocking China. And I'm not knocking Mexico. And I'm not knocking Japan. I'm not knocking anybody. I think it's great what they do for themselves. But I am knocking our leadership as being grossly incompetent. They don't know what the hell they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. And every time, and in all fairness, China is just one of many, but China is the biggest, and it's the biggest abuser. China's an abuser. They abuse our country. Every time they start doing badly, do you notice? They knock out their currency a little bit lower, a little bit lower. They're not supposed to be doing that. That's sort of like cheating, you know? It's a way of cheating. Now, we do it very little because we don't know how to play. They're like grandmasters. They're like grandmasters, and we're like checker players that don't know how to play. That's the difference. But it won't be that way. Carl Icahn, guys like Ruffin, guys like so many of my people that have backed me, so many of the people that Phil knows. These are the best business people in the world. These are the best negotiators in the world. These are the best negotiators in the world. And you know what? You know what? It's very interesting. We're going to put it up. I'm the best. Oh, I'm good. Good. But we have the best. We have the greatest business people. We have the greatest negotiators in the world. You know, we have the greatest. Andy Beal, who's a big supporter. Andy Beal, Beal Bank in Texas. We have such unbelievable people that are supporting me. And they support me not because they like me, although I guess that's a part of it, but they're supporting me because they hear me. You ever hear corporate inversion? We have companies that are leaving this country. Taxes are too high. And they have trillions of dollars outside of our country. They can't get it back. We can't get it back. Because we have no leader. You know, we have trillions of dollars right now outside of our country. I think it's $5 trillion. They say it's $2.5 trillion. I think it's much more. We can't bring it back. The Democrats want to bring it back. The Republicans want to bring it back. Everybody, who the hell doesn't want to bring it back? It's money that we aren't allowing to come back in. Because the bureaucracy, it's actually not just taxes. The taxes are crazy. Only a maniac would bring it back and pay those. It's crazy, too high. We pay the highest taxes in the world. By the way, I have the biggest tax decrease of any candidate that's run for office, and that's close to 20 people. And Hillary Clinton, has the biggest tax increase, and she doesn't even want to talk about it. In my opinion, her taxes have to be close to 60% to pay for what she's talking about. And she got forced into a corner by crazy Bernie. One thing about Bernie, he doesn't give up. This guy doesn't give up, right? Crazy Bernie, he doesn't give up. You know, crazy Bernie, he's crazy as a bed bug, but you know, he doesn't quit. He doesn't quit. Gotta hand it to him. And I think Bernie should continue to go forward, folks. He should continue to go forward. He should fight to the last end. Well, he's waiting for really the FBI to do what everybody thinks they're going to do. I mean, I think I think he's sort of saying, look, let's hang in there, because ultimately it's called the FBI convention. And then we'll be the only people, and we will have done something like Trump did. I want to be like Trump. I want to be like Trump. But I think he's waiting for the FBI convention. We'll see. We'll see. We'll see if the right thing happens. Everybody knows what the right thing is. I've watched and read and seen and talked to great legal scholars. Not one has said that she should be allowed to run for office. Every person that we know of that's done far less than what she's done, their lives have been destroyed. And the press doesn't cover it because the press is so one-sided. CNN, as an example, it's called the Clinton News Network. Clinton News Network. No, it's a joke. It's a joke. The Clinton News Network. So we'll see what happens. But Bernie is in there, and Bernie's fighting, and I don't think he should give up. Does anybody think so? I don't think so. If he gives up, we'll say, Bernie, you're a loser. You gave up. We can't do it. No, but we'll see. I mean, he's got to have something in mind, and I personally think that's maybe what he has in mind. So we're going to do things for our country that are going to be amazing. And they've resonated. Look, 1 year from Thursday, I ran. And everybody said, June 16th, 1 year. So it's 1 year and 2 days now. 1 year. 1 year. And a lot of people said, I watched Karl Rove. He said, oh, he's not going to run. Oh, go ahead. I watched Krauthammer. No, he won't run. Krauthammer said, he won't run. He won't run because this is the single greatest group of talent, perhaps in the history of the Republican Party. In fact, a month before, I said to my wife, wow, I just don't forget, Krauthammer wanted us to go into Iraq and bomb the hell. We did a great job by doing that, and I was against doing that, folks. I was against it. These guys all wanted to bomb the hell out of Iraq. We've done a great job in doing that. We've totally destabilized the Middle East. What a mess we have, okay? What a total mess we have. And by the way, who takes over Iraq? Iran. Not only do they make the Iran deal, I used to say that's the greatest deal I've seen. They got $150 billion back. They have the right to go wild with nuclear weapons eventually. They don't need to make them. They can buy them. But you know what? They make great. Now, I used to say that's one of the greatest deals I've ever seen. I don't say that anymore. Greatest deal is that for years and years and years, decades and decades, they fought each other. And one went 10 feet this way, 10 feet that way, 10 feet, 3-4 years. Then they rested. Then they go again, again, again. Saddam Hussein drops a little gas. Iran complains, you're not supposed to do that. The world goes crazy. And then they rest. Then again. Okay, this has gone on forever. Then we come in and obliterate one of the two. Obliterated. And now what have we done? We have given Iran Iraq. Okay? As sure as you're sitting there, I've been saying this for a long time, but Iran is essentially controlling Iraq. Iran is now, very shortly, going to just walk in. They don't have to fire a shot. And the people running Iraq are so in the pocket of Iran. And why wouldn't they be? Because they figure we're gone. You know, we're gone. So Iran is going to take over Iraq. A lot of people don't know that Iraq has some of the largest oil reserves in the entire world. A lot of people don't know that. So look what's happening. Look what's happening to Iran. Look what we've done by sheer stupidity. So a lot of these people, they said, bomb, bomb, bomb. And I said, what did I know? I was in business, right? I didn't know. A lot of people weren't asking me. But I said, if you do that, you're going to destabilize the Middle East. And hence you have the migration. And hence you have people going all over the world. Look at the problems in Germany. Look at the crime. I have friends in Germany that for years would say, the greatest country, the greatest country. They love Germany. Now they're saying, we're leaving. They were leaving Germany. Look what they've done to different, look at Brussels. How beautiful a place was Brussels. And look at what's going on. Look at Paris. Look what's happening in Paris. And it's far worse than you people understand. It's far worse than people understand. In fact, today there was actually a story that Paris is so out of control, so dangerous. Look at what's going on. And we have Hillary Clinton wanting to take in over 500% more than Obama. No, think of it. Than Obama of people that will cause us problems like you will not believe. Not all of them. But look what one man did. One whack job. He's a wacko. Look what one whack job did. One radical Islamic terrorist. And he pledged himself to ISIS. Here's a guy, he's shooting people and pledging himself to ISIS as he's shooting. Okay? He's calling people and talking about ISIS. ISIS. Look what one man has done to this country. Look at what one man has done to the state, to the great, great, great state of Florida that I love, and Orlando, amazing place. This is one man. We're letting in millions of people. It doesn't take large amounts. This could be the great Trojan horse. We all know the story of the Trojan horse. But this could be the great story of the Trojan horse. All because we have leadership and weak people like Hillary. She's weak. She's weak. Bernie Sanders said about Hillary Clinton that she can't be president because she has bad judgment. Okay, he said it. I didn't say it. I would never say a thing like that. And then I hear her saying, you know, reading right off, always teleprompters. She goes, Donald Trump does not have the temperament to be president. And then the people back, oh, she gave a great speech. Oh, give me a break. Gave her a great speech. You think she's the president? Take a look at her. You think she's the president? I don't think so. I don't think so. Donald Trump doesn't have the temperament. And I'll tell you something. I started thinking about it. And I was going to say, I absolutely have a great temperament. And I've done great things. Hey, look, I went into television, had The Apprentice. Great hit. One of the most successful reality shows, right? I did books. Many bestsellers, many. The Art of the Deal is one of the biggest selling, certainly the biggest selling business book of all time, by far. So I did books, tremendous success. Real estate, I have some of the greatest assets in the world. You look at my numbers, very low debt, tremendous everything, okay? I filed over 100 and some odd pages. But listen to this, okay, so listen. So we have a great study in contrast. So I started thinking about temperament, and I was going to say, I do have a good temperament, I do. And then I said to myself, well, wait a minute. She's probably right about one thing. I have a very tough temperament. She said, you know, but very controlled. But we need tough temperament today. We can't have this weakness. We can't have weakness. My temperament's tough. My temperament is very solid. I don't lose control. I've been doing this for a long time, folks. You've been watching me for a long time. Do you know in New York, I won in a massive landslide. Who knows me better than the people of New York? Nobody knows me better. Nobody. I won in a massive landslide and we had three people. Now New York knows me better. I've been there for a long time. If I didn't have a good temperament, I couldn't have won New York. They know me. Do I get publicity? They write about me every day, every hour. It's always been this way. I don't know why. I don't know why. They had their debate. So Fox in the debate had 24 million people. It's actually even more than that, but 24 million people. The largest audience in the history of cable television. Now, I don't think it was for Jeb, but maybe I'm wrong, okay? By the way, Jeb is working on the movement, just so you understand. I love competition like that. I love it. So look. Low energy. I didn't say it, you did. Okay. No, Jeb is one of the people that's working. And the other one should be obvious to you, but we'll figure that out very easily. Okay, ready? So when you look and when you see what we have to do, We have to get out there. We have 24 million people they watch. We have 23. The next 2 weeks, CNN puts on a debate. 23 million people. The largest audience in the history of cable television for CNN. CNN covers wars, covers everything, right? So you have the largest audience in the history of cable television. And then a few weeks later, oh yeah, they do say the debate with Hillary will be, it's going to blow everything away. Oh, I look forward to that debate. Oh, do I look forward to that debate. I look so forward to that debate. But think of this. So CNN, a few weeks later, has another debate. And they get the largest audience they've ever had in the history of CNN. You know, it's pretty impressive, right? And Variety and the magazines say the Trump debate drew record ratings. Okay, just like they said the prophets. But here's the thing about the debate. So the debates go on, and a lot of people say, what was the biggest surprise? Well, I didn't know myself as a debater because I never debated. I create jobs, I do deals, I do business, I do this stuff, right? I don't debate. I guess my life is a debate, but I don't debate professionally. And I hear all these politicians, they're debaters. We debate. Hillary Clinton supposedly is a debater. Give me a break. Will she be allowed to bring the teleprompter onto the debate stage? So what happens is we start the debates, and I never did it before. And I'm saying, but think of that. I was in 11 debates, and of the 11 debates, I think it was 11, of the 11 debates, I was on center stage for every single debate, meaning you're number one. And of the 11 debates, Drudge, fantastic guy, Time Magazine, Slate, they do polls. I think I really help the polling business, right? I talk about polls. I like polls. But only if I'm winning. I don't like them otherwise. And we're starting to catch up very rapidly, so pretty soon. The polling companies are going to have their day in the sun pretty soon, I think. But here's the story. So of all of these debates, I think there's seven of them they cover, they have online polls. Hundreds of thousands of people vote. And on every single debate, by every single poll, I won every debate, which is pretty good. You know, I don't know. I think it's pretty good. But we are going to do things that are going to be great. And a lot of people don't want me in because they don't want to see strong borders. Okay? They don't want to see strong. I want to see strong borders. They don't want to see me job creating. They don't want to see what I'm going to do to help the minorities because we have problems in this country. I will do more for African Americans than Barack Obama has ever, ever, ever done. And believe me, he's done nothing. He's done nothing but talk. And the Hispanics. So I employ thousands of Hispanics. Thank you. Where's Miriam? Where is Miriam? Where is she? Thank you. No, I employ thousands of Hispanics. Where's Miriam? She's shy. She doesn't want to. She has been so amazing. Where is... Thank you. She goes around and says Donald Trump is going to do more for Mexicans and Hispanics, and I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you, darling. So nice. No, she's been amazing, and she knows because I'm going to bring our jobs back, folks. We're bringing our jobs back. Look at Carrier. They fired everybody. They're moving to Mexico. So many companies moving to Mexico. I mean, I have a list that's a mile long. They're moving to Mexico, firing everybody. Then they make the product, not only in Mexico, they make the product. They sell it into the United States. No tax, no nothing. And you know what happens? We're going to lose a lot more companies, folks. We're going to lose a lot more companies. If I'm president, we're not going to lose anything. We're not going to lose any companies. We're not going to lose. And I say that strongly. Because you know what? These guys don't know. I've been watching this discussion because for 7 or 8 years, we have been just, it's been an onslaught. And longer than that, in all fairness to Obama, long before Obama, it was called NAFTA. It was signed by Bill Clinton. And it didn't affect Bill Clinton, but it affected everybody that followed Bill Clinton. And believe me, folks, it has been a disaster for this country. When I won New York State and Pennsylvania, when I won Maryland and Connecticut and Rhode Island, when I won all of these states, and then won Indiana, thank you, Bobby Knight. Boy, did Bobby Knight help. Boy, did Bobby Knight. That was a coach night, 900 wins. But when I won all of these states, I really got to know, even New York State, I knew it well. I knew there were tremendous problems upstate New York, but I had no idea. When I toured those upstate areas of Albany and Rome, the real Rome, Rome, New York, okay, that's, I call that the real Rome. But Syracuse, and you see building after building after building, empty, falling down, just a horrible sight all over. You could buy them, folks, you could buy them for a dollar. And you know what? I'll give you maybe some real estate advice. Go out and buy them, and if I win, you're going to make a hell of a lot of money. Okay? In fact, Phil Ruffin will get up and leave before the speech is over. He's headed to upstate New York right now. No, but it's true. It's true. Building after, by the thousands, by the thousands. And I have statisticians that work for me. And before I used to speak when we were in the primary, I'd say, give me the information on upstate New York. Give me the information on Long Island. Give me the information on all of these different places, Pennsylvania in particular. Look at West Virginia, what they've done to our coal miners. They've destroyed. Hillary Clinton said, I'll put the coal miners and the mines out of business. That was not a smart statement. And then she had to go there far away from. And look at the numbers I've gotten in West Virginia and Pennsylvania. But I look, because we're going to bring the coal industry back, and we're going to bring every industry. We're going to bring our energy industry back. We're going to bring it back. We're going to bring it back. You know, because of technology, folks, because of technology, we have learned things, frankly, and we realize that we have wealth that we never knew we had. Over the last 6 or 7 years, there are many forms of technology that have given us an awareness that's unbelievable. What's happened is unbelievable. So we're going to bring all these things back, and we're going to start paying off our debt, and we're not going to let our companies. Now, here's what we're going to do. So Carrier says they're leaving. I would call them and say very nicely, and you know, my wife gives me a very hard time. She said, darling, you're president. You cannot call an air conditioning company. I said, that's okay. It's so much fun. It's like a two-minute call. If I can say 1,400 jobs in 2 minutes, let me do it. But I'd call, meaning I'd call, somebody calls, I got to call. Maybe I should do it, right? And I say very simply, you just fired 1,400 people, you're moving to Mexico, enjoy it, enjoy it. I respect Mexico so much for taking all of our businesses, so much of our business. But let me just tell you, here's the story. Every air conditioning unit that you make, that you sell across our now very, very strong border, you will be paying a 35% tax on that unit, if you live. If you live. Now, our country has been working on this problem for years, and they did all sorts of deals, like zero interest loans, and we'll give you money. They don't need money. They don't want money. How about the deals where they gave them really cheap money and they left anyway? You know, I mean, it's like, great. Try collecting. They don't need money. 100% they don't need. If I talk to them for 2 minutes, Phil, would you say 2 minutes or do I need three? I think in two. He says one. He's Phil. Phil said 1 minute. But in a quick conversation, we're not going to move. And they're not going to be calling lobbyists because, you know, I spent $55 million on my own campaign of my money, okay, of my money. And by the way, if the Republican Party, and I hope they all come together because I want them to come together, it's great. But if for any reason they get a little bit like they don't want to help out as much, then I'll fund my own campaign. I'd love to do that. I'd love to do that. You know, right now I'm raising a lot of money for the Republican Party and a lot of beneficiaries to that, and I like doing it. But we have to have help. We have to have help. They have to be, it's got, you know, life is like a two-way street, right? It's a two-way street. So they have to, otherwise I'll just keep doing what I'm doing. I'll just keep funding my own campaign. I'm okay with that. That's the easy way. I mean, for me, that's the easy way. But hopefully I can continue to go the way we're going. This weekend we raised a lot of money. We've raised a lot of money for the Republican Party. We'll keep doing it because we do have tremendous support within the party. That I can tell you. We have tremendous support. Okay. So what's going to happen with Kerry, or what's going to happen with any of, is they're going to say, we want to talk about this. Then they're going to go hire lobbyists. The lobbyists are going to call. I say, I'm not giving you guys anything. Now, if they call Hillary, 100%, they have a lobby. They have a lobbyist in Washington. He's got Hillary Clinton stamped on his forehead. Okay, it's 100%. With me, it doesn't work that way, okay? With me, it doesn't work that way. Within 24 hours, they will call and say, sir, we've decided to stay in the United States. We'll stay in Indiana. Or they'll go someplace else, but they're staying in the United States. Now multiply that times thousands and thousands of companies. That's what you're talking about. You're not talking about 100 companies or 10. You're talking about thousands of companies have left. Thousands of companies are being killed by monetary manipulation. Okay? Thousands. We're not going to let this happen. Remember this. China, we have rebuilt China. They have taken so much. You know, we owe China now $1.7 trillion. Think of it. They beat us at every front. They kicked the hell out of us, and we owe them money. How about Japan? We owe Japan $1.6 trillion. Now, think of that one. They sell the cars. The big boats come in. The biggest ships you've ever seen. I mean, if Wayne Newton could ever get his big audiences onto one of those ships, you would be very proud. I'm telling you, Wayne. Wayne, would you stand up again? Come on. I mean, we love this guy. We love Wayne. We love our, you know, it's sort of like a weird experience because all of my life I've been watching Wayne Newton and now I'm performing for him. What the hell is going on over here? And the problem is, I like him better than I like myself. So anyway, so all of this is going to come back. Now, you have people in both parties that don't like the things I'm saying, okay? You have people in both parties. But you know, because I have the smartest people. A lot of people are saying that. That's even showing up. I have the most dedicated people. I have the best people. I have the best people. I have the best people. And they get it. But a lot of people don't like strong borders. They don't want the wall. We're going to have the wall, folks. We've got to have the wall. We've got to have the wall. And the wall is going to stop drug trafficking. It's going to help with the drug. You know, the drugs are pouring into our country and poisoning our youth and others beyond what anybody has any idea. If you look at New Hampshire, which I won. I love New Hampshire because it was my first victory. It's my first victory. I never ran for office. By the way, am I doing a good job? Am I doing a good job? Right? I never did this before. But I love New Hampshire. And the people of New Hampshire got together with me and they said their biggest problem is heroin. I said, heroin? You know, it just doesn't work with the beautiful trees and streams and lakes. I said, heroin. And it turns out to be, they have it tremendous. And they have it in Massachusetts. And they have it in South Carolina. They have it in all of these places. All of these places. And it's pouring across. And 3 weeks ago, 16,500 Border Patrol agents endorsed Donald Trump. They've never, ever endorsed a presidential candidate. And I asked them, and they told me, they said, Mr. Trump, you need the wall. And Sheriff Joe Arpaio, great guy, tough, right? Sheriff Joe from Arizona. In fact, when I finish this, I'm going to Arizona. I'll be in Arizona in a little while doing the same thing with big, big, beautiful crowds. But Sheriff Joe endorsed Donald Trump. Folks, we know what we're doing, okay? We know what we're doing. We are going to make this country so strong again. We're going to save your Social Security. We're going to save your Second Amendment, which Hillary Clinton wants to abolish. Hillary Clinton wants to abolish your Second Amendment. And I got the endorsement of the National Rifle Association, the NRA. One of the earliest endorsements they've ever given. And let me tell you, between Wayne and Chris and all of those people, these are great people. These are people, and it gets lost. It gets lost in the debate. These are people that love our country. Just remember that. These are people that love our country. And you know, I've said before, some people thought it was a harsh statement, but if in Paris, where 130 people died, toughest gun laws in the world, by the way, there were no guns on the other side. These thugs walked in. Probably if they were, if they knew there were, they wouldn't have gone in there in the first place, okay? They knew there were no guns. But toughest gun laws in the world, 130 people die. San Bernardino, 14 people die. Friends, they were friends. They killed the 14 people and so many so badly injured. By the way, Paris, the hospitals are still loaded with people. So horrible. And what we had this weekend. If there were a couple of folks, man, woman, had a gun strapped right here, right here, right here. Or a gun strapped very nicely to the ankle. And this no good, sick, perverted, horrible terrorist, was in there starting the shooting. One of those people would have had those bullets going the other way, folks. It would have been a whole different story. Would have been a whole different story. So we're going to make our nation rich again. We're a poor nation. We lose to everybody. We defend Japan. They don't pay us the right money. They will. They will. You know, the press never says the second. I said, no. In a deal, you always have to be prepared to walk. They'll tell you that. You always have to be prepared. Not that you want to walk, but you have to be prepared. So here's Hillary Clinton when she heard about what I said about Japan. She is not being loyal to our allies. We will always stay with our allies. Well, now, they're never going to negotiate. Why would they negotiate? Why? But we have all of these nations that we defend. South Korea. Try buying a television outside of South Korea. Not easy. I buy thousands and thousands of television sets. Very tough to buy them outside of South Korea, except for Sony, which is not doing so well lately, okay, from Japan. But let me just tell you, South Korea, we defend. Costs us a fortune. They pay something, but not what they should be paying. Japan, we defend. Billions and billions of dollars. A general gets up. Donald Trump is wrong. He was sent by Obama. Nice-looking guy, general. He said, doesn't he understand that Japan pays us 50% of the cost? So he's saying Japan pays us 50% of the cost of their defense. So the press called me up, Mr. Trump, they said that Japan pays 50% of the cost. How do you respond? I said, why don't they pay 100%, right? Yeah. Right? I mean, we're defending Japan. So we defend Germany. Think Germany's a rich nation? I want to tell you, it's a rich nation. But I'll tell you what, gonna have problems with what she did, but regardless, rich nation. Now, we have Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, when the oil prices were high, was making $1 billion a day. We pay rent on our bases. We pay them rent. We defend Saudi Arabia. Now listen. Saudi Arabia, I have a lot of friends from Saudi Arabia, all that stuff, right? But you know what? This is a country that has nothing but money. They have nothing but money. Not strong defense. That if we weren't there, they would have been gone 25 years ago, okay? 25 years ago. You remember the incident with Iraq, when Iraq went into Kuwait, and then they started looking at Saudi Arabia. And the Saudis didn't do so well. And then we had those Marines of ours with the stuff under their eyes, and boy, that was the end of that. Remember that? People forget these little stories, folks. So we defend Saudi Arabia. They don't pay us nearly what they should be paying. So essentially, we subsidize all of these countries. South Korea, with this guy, call him a maniac, call him whatever you want. Every time he raises his hand or raises his head, we send our ships, our planes, our this. We have 28,000 soldiers on the line between North and South Korea. They pay us peanuts. How stupid are we? How stupid are we? A country like Saudi Arabia wouldn't exist for a week. You know, when Iran took over Yemen, they don't want Yemen. They want the border because it's a huge, long border between Saudi. They want the oil in Saudi Arabia. That's why they fight for Yemen. That's why they're in there fighting. Think of this. We're making a deal with Iran, and we're fighting Iran in Yemen. When you make the deal, aren't you supposed to sort of solve everything? And Kerry said he didn't want to bring it up because he didn't want to complicate the negotiation. This guy's an idiot. Now think of it. Yemen. We're fighting them. They're on the other side. We're on one side. We don't know whose side we're on because, you know, we're on the side of the rebels. We have no idea who the rebels are. You ever see all our rebels? Our rebels turned out to be worse than the guys that were there in the first place. We're on the side of the rebels. And then the rebels turn out to be like the worst. But we're fighting Iran. They're on the other side. And we're fighting. And he's out there negotiating. Then he goes on a bicycle race. He breaks his leg at 73. And I tell people, I give you my word, I will never enter a bicycle race, I promise, during a major negotiation. I mean, the guy comes out, he's got a whole thing with the outfit, the helmet, the whole deal, right? The helmet, I think he even had the stickers on him, right? I said, what is this guy? He thinks he's in the Tour de France or something. What is he doing? We're in the middle of a very important negotiation that, frankly, he should have walked away from until we got our prisoners back. And he should have never agreed to give back the $150 billion. But here's a guy in the middle of a negotiation, breaks his leg, and he's out of business. I mean, I can't tell you, folks. It is, and I think the reason I have this tremendous support is because, you know what? A lot of it's common sense, okay? A lot of it's common sense. It's not even like, you know, you could say he's a great businessman. A lot of it's common sense. 99% of the people in this room would do just as well. I mean, it's like simple stuff. We're being led by people that don't know what they're doing. Now, here's what's going to happen. So we're going to start winning again. We're going to have strong borders. We're going to have the wall. We're going to be respected again. We're going to win with our military. We're going to knock the hell out of ISIS. We have to do that, folks. That I have to tell you. Normally, I would say no. But it's gotten to a point, and because of the power of weaponry, we have to do that. We really have no choice. So we're going to knock the hell out of them. But our military is totally depleted. You see our old jets where we're taking parts from plane airplane graveyards and museums. We have the planes in the museums and we're using them as our fighters. And other countries have modern fighter jets. This is the United States of America. Can you believe what's happening to us? So we're going to, our military is depleted, horribly depleted, smaller than it's been in many, many years. And it's probably got to be bigger right now because I don't know if there's ever been much more of a threat than we have right now. So we're going to build up our military with the equipment that we want. We're going to take care of our veterans because our veterans have been horribly, horribly treated. We're going to make great, great trade deals and we're going to bring jobs and money back into our country. We're going to create a border and borders generally that are strong and powerful. We're going to get rid of Common Core, and we're going to bring our education locally. We're going to repeal and replace that horror show called Obamacare. And we are going to save our Second Amendment. We are going to save it. So, folks, you've heard it before, and I say it all the time. We don't win anymore, but we're going to win so much. And I love it. And I'll say it in honor of the people of Las Vegas, in honor of Mr. and Mrs. Wayne Newton, in honor of Miriam, in honor of Mr. and Mrs. Phil Ruffin, and in honor of everybody in all. Wow, look at this place. Ooh. TSA finally came through for us. Look at the corners of those rooms. Look at the corners of those rooms. What a beautiful sight. All over the building. So here's what's going to happen. We're going to start winning again. We're going to win with our military. We're going to win for our vets. We're going to win on education. We're going to win on trade. We're going to win, win, win. We're going to win so much. And I'll be in the White House. And they'll say, Mr. President, sir, we have a problem. Thousands of people from Las Vegas, from Nevada, from Texas, where we just left, from all of the states, by the thousands, they're calling, sir. They can't stand winning so much. They're not used to winning. They want you to take it easy. And I'll say, I'm sorry, folks, I can't do that, because we are going to make America great again, greater than ever before.